Well, the reason that I'm interested in bimodal fittings, there are a number of reasons. Let's just talk through a few. I think let's go back and talk about what are bimodal fittings. It's when a child uses a cochlear implant at one ear and a hearing aid at the non-implanted ear. And what we are seeing as implant candidacy guidelines start to expand, we're including children with more residual hearing. And the research literature has shown that there are benefits to using that hearing aid in the ear, the unimplanted ear, in addition to the cochlear implant. So I think it's very important for our children to get the most benefit they can from the two devices. And I think it's always important that our children get binaural stimulation of the auditory pathways, be it two hearing aids, a cochlear implant and a hearing aid, or two cochlear implants. The project that I'm going to be talking about here today is how to best fit the hearing aid in addition to the cochlear implant. And specifically today, I'm going to present data looking at adjusting the frequency response of the hearing aid to three different frequency responses. One is what we would call a traditional wideband response, where we're trying to amplify the acoustic information across the hearing range as much as we can, given that child's residual hearing. The second is actually restricting the response of the hearing aid to mainly the low frequency range, because generally children that are using bimodal fittings at the hearing aid ear, they tend to have more residual hearing in the low frequency range. So we're going to restrict that to where we have the most aidable hearing, and that typically means we're going to cut the high frequencies. And then the third response that we are going to look at is activating frequency compression in the hearing aid. And so each child wears all three of those responses for 3 to 4 weeks, and then they come in and they're tested with those responses. And our test battery looks at a number of outcome measures, because I think if you just look at one speech perception test, that doesn't tell you the whole story. So we're going to look at speech perception in quiet with words. We're going to look at sentence perception in noise. We are going to look at the ability to localize, tell where the words are coming from across 15 speakers. And then lastly, we will be looking at, can you tell the difference if you have two female talkers? Was that the same talker, or is that two different talkers? And the same with male talkers. So we'll be looking at a number of outcome measures and comparing those responses for each individual participant in the study. So we were looking at individual data as well as group data, because as clinician, what's important? Group data is important, but what we really learn is that one size does not fit all. And so we'll look at individual data and which child was performing which different setting and across each different outcome measure. And importantly, at the end of this study, we ask the children to indicate which setting they prefer to listen to in their everyday listening environment. So the key findings from the study is that one frequency hearing aid response wasn't the best for all children. Some performed best with compression, some performed best with wideband or restricted. Now, interestingly, at the end of the study, the majority of the children did prefer frequency compression, but again, a couple preferred restricted. So I think it really points to the fact that as clinicians, we need to have a number of options. We need to have a hearing aid that's adjustable so that we can meet each one's unique needs and each one's preferences.